Now that we've looked at the Tower Game Starter Kit game class and examined the three different states that the game can be in when going over and over in the render loop, all we have left to take a look at in the source code is the various gameplay and utility functions at the bottom of the file. These run the gamut from dealing with user input to little things like detecting when the game is over. So what comes first? A few utility functions related to chopping up an image into smaller pieces used by sprite sheets and stuff. And then some simple functions related to operating system level things. For example, sometimes we need to pause the game in Windows 8, for example, when somebody's minimized a window or moved it over to the side of the screen in that little tiny 320 pixel wide mode. And then apart from that, little functions that are called by the AI when they happen to reach their goal. For example, we want to attack the castle and reduce the player's health and check to see if there's game over or not. And then here, the entity AI function takes a sprite that we'll call enemy and helps the sprite decide what it should be doing next. Firstly, it moves its health bar sprite to could always hover directly above itself. If it happens to have any particles it needs to emit, then that entity can emit an explosion or whatever. If it happens to have a weapon, and it happens to have a reference to a sprite list of enemies, which in this case are your towers, then if enough time has elapsed, the enemy could shoot, or the entity could shoot at one of its closest enemy. And so I measure how far other enemies are, and if it's the right time and the right place to attack, then it will. Of course, this means that you could make the little enemies attack and possibly destroy towers in your game. That, as well, is left as an exercise to the listener. In our game, in the Peasants Are Revolting example game, the only entities that actually have weapons are the towers. But you could easily change that, which is fun. Finally, all entities have a speed property. Which is used only by our moving little baddies, but as mentioned before, you could make it so your towers move around as well, as if you want. All entities are just one class, towers and little army dudes. Finally, we have some sound initializations and gameplay events taken care of, such as whether the level's been completed or a game over, whether or not we beat the game or died, so we can congratulate or console the player as required. And finally, just a few simple functions related to updating the numerical displays on screen, which will change which sprites we're displaying depending on what number we want to display. Finally, there's a function here which is an important one that gets used init level, and all it does is parse level data. You can see an example of it here. This here is the level data for level 1, and it is an array of numbers that defines whether a square is walkable or not. And the init level function just gobbles that up and makes sure we have a proper terrain sprite, we're ready for a brand new level, and tells the A star pathfinding class to use this particular level's path data. And now a function to create an entity. That means one of the little bad guys or one of the towers. And it just gets put at a world location. The race is whether or not it's a skeleton or a man or a woman or what have you, or which tower it is. And team, team good or team bad, as mentioned earlier. That's the player's team or the computer's team. So apart from that, a few other utilities at the very bottom here, one that removes one when they die, and one that's happens when a victim is damaged by a perpetrator, and we need to reduce the health. Finally, functions, more gameplay functions, like detecting when the level is complete. This just makes sure, it asks the question, are there any more enemies? Are there any pending waves? If not, then the level's done. Finally, a few functions for just moving the build menu around and figuring out what tile was clicked or touched on by player input. And after the build menu stuff, some GUI click stuff as well. Pointer down events are handled, which end up going out to these functions above for whether we clicked on the main menu or in-game. Finally, a little tween that moves the camera smoothly depending on where we want it to be centered in on. A little initialization of the Microsoft-specific touch events that generally only get used in the Windows 8 version of the game. This is a fun function, the liquid layout function, which may have to be tweaked if you're making a true a resizable game. And all it does is measure the width of the camera and move various sprites over just to be centered on screen or up against the top of the screen or along the bottom of the screen, depending on the size of the canvas. This is really helpful because once you've coded something like this, you don't have to worry about what resolution the game is running in, whether you're on a huge HD monitor or not. Everything will be in the right place, and whenever there's a resize event called in the browser, the liquid layout GUI function will fire and nudge things around so they're in the right locations. Finally, we have handling the different waves. We want to spawn entities depending on what time, how much time has passed, if there are available entities that we need to spawn before the level's over. Simple as can be, it's really just checking to see, is it time to spawn another enemy? Okay, then go for it. As I mentioned, the on resize event is the one that kicks off whenever somebody changes the shape of the screen, and it's important to pause the game, for example, if it's too small to actually render, but otherwise all it does is nudge some stuff around and make sure that we know the size of the canvas. And finally, this is the function that's called init tower game starter kit, which is the first initialization that's done the second this JavaScript file is loaded, and it's run immediately. And we first set up, we create a canvas in the HTML file. That's why you'll see it here. We don't even have it here in the body of the HTML because it's inserted in code. And we fire up the profiler, which only actually does anything if we're in debug mode, and possibly fire up the sound routines and load the level data. And then we put that array of file names that was at the very top of the file that has all the different PNG and, you know, all the image data that we need to preload before the game is ready. And that's put into a queue for loading, so that once everything is created and we start, we fire up the canvas rendering engine, this function here, jaws.start, will create a title screen state. Remember the states we mentioned earlier? Only once all the game assets have been loaded. And that's why occasionally you'll get this brief moment of 5%, 10%, 20%, a little progress bar that happens in while the assets are being downloaded online. Now, it runs very quickly if you're running natively on Windows Phone or Windows 8, but it all happens that way. And that way, this transition is deferred until all the data is ready to be used. And that's pretty much it. A couple functions related to that simple little joke of an NPC cinematic at the beginning of each level. And all it does is kick off an MP3 file and change what's displayed on screen, and it only happens once. And that's it. Here we are at the very bottom of the file, and this is the only piece of code that executes the moment towergamestarterkit.js is fully downloaded. All it does is create a global variable called game, and what class is it? It's the class we defined above, towergamestarterkit, which has all those private members and functions that we've just done a little tour of. So I hope that helps to let you become a little bit more familiar with the code base of Tower Game Starter Kit. I believe that it's really very simple. It's a large file, though, and that can be a little intimidating, but consider the fact that I've tried my best to make the code self-documenting. I've thrown all sorts of comments in there to help you along the way, but don't be afraid to experiment or tear stuff out and just put a few things into your own game. Design the structure of your code the way you prefer to do it, whether it's very oop or not oop at all. You can do it your way, and this is just a simple little example that hopefully will be a way for you to skip square one in the creation of an HTML5 tower game that runs on the web and on Windows 8 as an app and as a Windows Phone 8 app. It also has been tested to work on other platforms, Android, iOS, and all the rest, because this is just standard HTML5. A Of course, there are always gotchas when trying to make HTML5 work on platform X. In particular, there are headaches associated with sound and also with user input, because some platforms will have a joystick, others will be touchscreen. But the engine itself is designed to be very performant, to typically run at 60 frames a second on all platforms, optimistically, of course. Well, I just hope you enjoy playing around with it. It was a joy to make, and hopefully you can use this Tower Game Starter Kit as square one of your multi-month project, and if I've saved you a couple weeks of programming, then it's all worthwhile for me. So get in touch if you make a game with this, because I would love to see what you make. Good luck and enjoy.